right, welcome back. We're still on the live broadcast of the off-season election, where we're seeing who exactly will take over from the Kogi governor or the Bayelsa governor or the Imo State governor. And right now we're moving straight to Kogi, as we have our very own correspondent Mavis Akol waiting to tell us what exactly is happening there. Hello Mavis, what can you tell us this Saturday afternoon?
Good afternoon, Annabelle Oji. Well, right here in Kogi, like we first reported, we're actually at Honor Polling Unit. At can you hear me? We're actually at Honor Polling Unit at Ida Local Government Area. That's the local government area of the SDP candidate, governorship candidate. And right here at this polling unit, I think what we experienced in the previous polling unit that we have passed at, across Kogi State, is that they have basically large turnout of voters. Massive turnout of voters that is even overwhelming for the security operatives. And one of the things is that we haven't had any security challenges at this polling unit. But the security operatives are saying that the crowd is so massive for them to control. But one thing they are glad about is that the crowd, the electorate, are cooperating. They are cooperating and ensuring that there is a violent free election. Except for some places we went to that wasn't so far, some of the local government area, some of the areas around them, the same Ida local government, where they experienced there was almost voters actually, they sent out some some lawmakers who came, they said past lawmakers, past House of Assembly members came to buy votes, bribe them for votes, give them money to buy votes, and they chased them out. We got there at the scene when the person was leaving. I think this is actually a positive, yes, this is a positive one for the voters. This time around, they are clearly rejecting any form of vote buying. They are clearly rejecting any form of vote buying. It happened in two different, around the same local government, it happened, but they rejected the votes. I can even see, I think they are done with a particular election, because I can see on the bike, the INEC official is going with his electoral materials, probably he's returning back to the site. A bike just passed us and he's carrying his material. So for some places that the voters actually came out early, because at this polling unit, election started at 8:35 a.m. and okay, they have registered people are over 1,235 registered voters, and so far so good, over 300 have voted, and the voting process is still on. You can see how the people are rejoicing and doing one or two. They're just excited. According to them, most of them are saying they want this election to be a free and fair process and completely violence free. So we can actually call out some people to speak to them as to maybe they give us more of their what happened, what has happened here. So I'll go down to call one or two.
Okay.
Yes, there's someone here who wants to speak to us, so he's going to introduce himself and tell us how the voting exercise has happened here.
Okay.
What's been happening? Yes. Okay, so you can ask your question. He can hear you. Can you hear them?
Hello, sir. Good afternoon.
Can you hear?
Yeah, I can hear you now.
Okay, great. So we've heard from our correspondent that the election has been free, fair, and then violence free. Tell us what can you tell us with regards to the security, with regards to INEC officials? What exactly can you tell us?
Okay, all right, thank you very much. I think we can credit the INEC.
Okay.
This is 002. So, and we thank God for the way and manner the election is going on here. And we thank God for the security agencies and the INEC officials. I think they are trying their best, and the voters as well, they have been doing their best. I think the election is smooth and it's okay. So we thank God, and we believe and trust in God that the election is going to be smooth and perfectly.
Okay, so have you been able to cast your vote?
All right, can you hear him? Do you have more questions? Sorry, can you come again?
I was asking if he has been able to cast his own vote.
Can you come again? Okay, have you been able to cast your vote too?
Yes, Zylus, I've done that already. And there are more people who are still on queue and they are still going on. There's no any fight, there's no violence. And trusting God, believing God before four, and I think everything will be round up.
Oh, okay. So this is just a few minutes after two. Okay, this is just some minutes after
two.
Okay, yes, I can hear you. But I was going to actually ask with regards to voter apathy, even though I can see the crowd, the mammoth crowd right there. But so let's move straight to vote trading, for either buying or selling of votes. What can you tell us in this regard?
Right here, what I've seen, from the people, what I observed, I think it's a bit different from the past, what would I call it, presidential election, because I experienced firsthand where we went down to a particular voting unit, and we were wondering if it was going to be violence. We were wondering if there were going to be violence there, and then when we asked questions, we had some people speak to us and say they are, you know, the way they sang and chased a man out, they mocked the man who came to buy votes, who sent money to buy votes. He came with, it's just that we're not opportune to get the video early of the bag he took. But immediately they called security operatives. Even the youth were very, they were not ready to accept any vote buying. That's okay. What we saw. They were not ready to accept any vote buying. They immediately chased him away. If it's not, it was the interference of the, it was when the security operative came to help him out. That was what helped them. But what we saw here, what we saw around this local government is that they are not ready. The people are not ready to buy, to sell their votes.
Ah,
that's what
okay.
We have seen. We don't know if it, but they are not ready to sell their vote because we were far. If they were doing it because we were probably there, but we were far, they didn't see us coming.
Okay.
And they already started chasing him. So that means they're not ready to sell their votes.
Okay, so that's for the electorate. Now let's talk about the security officials, because we've seen how much sometimes they've become complicit, or they just decide to become to be bystanders, or just stand around and see these things happening and pretend to turn blind eye or deaf ears. Is that what you're seeing there?
Sorry, the crowd is so noisy. I don't know if you can repeat the question again. They're rejoicing.
Okay. So I was even going to ask, what exactly is making everybody rejoice? Have they started counting? And that's one on the side. And secondly, let's talk about the security officials. Are they complicit when it comes to vote trading, or are they just bystanders? Do your thing, and I'll pretend I didn't see it happen.
Okay. If I heard you correctly, first of all, why are they rejoicing? I think it's just, you know, when everyone, according to them, they said this election is the first time they are participating without the fear of violence.
Oh, wow.
So this is the first time most of them are coming out to participate in this election without being scared of one thing or the other. And they are doing this, they are participating because they see the full presence of security operatives. I mean, at almost every corner, at almost every junction of this local government, you have the presence of NSCDC, you have the presence of police operative, you have army checkpoints at every nook and cranny. So what I like about the security operatives is that if there's going to be any form, even if they hear a little probably shouting and rejoicing, immediately, They respond immediately.
That's great to hear.
Which is very, yes, I think they need to take applause for that. They respond immediately. They don't delay. I watched that in two different polling units. I heard some people were quarreling. It was just a quarrel between two persons. And immediately, before you know it, I just saw security operatives just appeared. So they are ready. They are keeping to their promise as they made that this election is going to be violent-free. So kudos to them.
Oh, great. That's great to hear. All right, so we'll let you go for now, Mavis, but we'll definitely call you back, especially when they start counting, so we'll find out what again you can tell us. But before we let you go, is there any other information that you might be leaving out that you might want to tell us?
None, except for the one I told you about, the fact that they are not ready to sell their vote, and
okay.
The fact that they came to, some people came to, outside that, I don't think there's anything for now, but if there is, we shall keep you up to date.
Thank you so much, Mavis Akol. We'll definitely call you to keep tabs on what is happening in your polling units. Do stay safe.
Thank you, Mavis.
Thank you, Annabelle.
All right, now, so let's come back here to the studio. I'm sure you must have listened to the fact that she said voter apathy. She talked about security officials, because I was thinking, I asked the question if we should be wary of the fact that some security officials might decide to be complicit, or they might just decide to turn a blind eye and say, do your thing, and we'll pretend like we didn't see it happen. But then she says she has not seen such happen, and then people are rejoicing at the fact that security is in check. Mm-hmm. So I'm trying to find the right word. Does this actually make you sleep with your two eyes closed, especially being an election observer?
Yeah, with what we heard from her, I think relatively there is peace in that polling unit where she's observing the election. And by and large, if you see what's happening at the polling unit, like I said earlier, it's going to be very difficult for you to rig elections in places like this, because everybody is together here. Mm. And they want to ensure that the right things are done. You see, that's why they are all together. So it's very difficult to win elections in places like this. But the good thing is here, is that she's just said it. She said the electorate refused to trade in their votes. That's one. Because these are the most challenges we have in 2023, and they will fought it. The second challenge we have, of course, in every election is either the votes are being bought by these politicians, or the KBQ, where these elections take place, is being positioned in such a way that the agents of political parties, after giving monies to the electorate, they position in such a way that once you cast your vote, once you thumbprint on the ballot paper, and you're taking it to the ballot box, they want you to show them who you voted for, so that you take your balance, because normally they don't give you all the money. If they promise you 10,000, they'll give you 5,000. And then when you go there, it's positioned, the KBQ is positioned in such a way that the agents of those political parties are hanging somewhere and be watching. So it's convenient for you. When you go into the KBQ, you thumbprint, and you're bringing it out to put it in the ballot box, you have to find a way to show them that, okay, I voted for your party.
Okay, so sorry I had to butt in there, because you said show them. I don't want this question to just leave my mind. We saw that footage where our correspondent showed us where you have the governorship candidate of SDP in Kogi State, that's Muritala Ajaka, where he finished, after he finished casting his vote, thumbprinting, he now showed his ballot paper, and it's shown right there on the screen. And I recall that we had this same argument when during the general elections, when former President Muhammadu Buhari did same. A lot of people lambasted him and said that was all shades and color of wrong. But then you have someone like the governorship candidate of SDP do the same thing, show people that this is even though we know that definitely he's not going to vote for some other party but his own party. But we're back here again. Why should we be discussing the same matter again?
You see, the truth is, Annabelle, if we leave our country for politicians, they'll mess us up. Politicians are a different type of species. The rules are there. If it's in the same society, that is already an electoral fraud. The president in 2023 general election will be arrested. The governor will be arrested, because you are not supposed to show the public who you voted for. But you see, we live in a society where everything goes on. And honestly, I feel so bad when those who think they are our leaders are the ones doing this. So tell me, when we are at the polling unit and you see an electorate who is so poor that is asking for 10,000, trying to show who he voted for, you won't be able to arrest that person, because he's giving you an instance of a president.
Or a governor candidate.
Did something. So you see, that's why I said this kind of system that we run and allow politicians to do whatever they want will destroy this democracy that we all fought for. I tell you, today we are enjoying this democracy, but in the long run, if we allow this kind of system, this kind of political jargons going on, it will destroy this democracy. Now, it's already in the electoral law that you don't expose your ballot paper to who you vote to the public. It's already there.
So does it mean that they don't know?
They do. And you see, the electoral body, the commission, is supposed to take control of this. And one thing again, I must say this before we go further, that we've been fighting, Polling Unit Ambassador of Nigeria has been fighting, that we must not allow the president to appoint the commission chairman.
What is the alternative?
The alternative is that we should bring bodies of legal practitioners.
Right.
Who will sit down, every person who wants to be, and we want to be the INEC chairman, will contest it.
Why legal practitioners? Why that profession?
Well, maybe because of what we have seen. I'm sure your question might arise because of what we have seen. Even the legal system has already been polluted itself. We can't even trust that legal system anymore.
Are you saying that the judiciary is not the last hope of the common man again?
It's not the last hope of the common man. The truth about it is that when you see red and you call it black, it becomes a problem. So, before now, that's what we've been, okay, bring bodies of, well, if we don't look at the judiciary, then we should look at professionals, people who have integrity. Now, we have a lot of Nigerians who have integrity, who will come together and elect the commission chairman. We must remove this appointment from the presidency. If not, he pays you, you have to do his bidding. Because the real money comes from him. If he doesn't approve, nothing happens. And that is why we still have this problem this day. But we must change that narrative, that the commission chairman must be appointed by a body of integrity, with the Nigerians who have integrity. Or we take it to the legal system where the judiciary should sit down, lawyers with integrity, proven integrity, should sit down and elect the commission chairman. I tell you, if we do that, and most of the legal system that come into the electoral laws now, that we say, we want every election result at the polling unit level uploaded to the IRF. If that is done, look at what is happening at that polling unit we saw. You cannot rig election at that polling unit. It will be difficult for you to rig election at that polling unit because everybody is waiting. Everybody wants to see the result. You only cause trouble in that polling unit if you want to do any other thing. So everybody, and that's how it is in all the polling units. We have done the feasibility study of this. We have seen that election will be impossible to be rigged at the polling unit.
Right.
And the only way we can do this, ensure that all polling unit results uploaded to the IRF.
Right, just to cut in here, what you've mentioned is a number of times, and it's making me wonder, have you heard any reports? I mean, from our point of view here, we've been hearing reports, but unlike the general elections where that issue of uploading results was very key, when we called and we received calls, what's it called now, correspondents, observers, they would say this polling units, they are still waiting for the results to be uploaded. The returning officer says that there's no network and so on and so on. We've not even heard of that. Do you think it is still something in play, like in reality, or is it just that because of what we've been seeing so far, it's just something that, well, if it happens, fine, if it doesn't, not. Do you think there's still any attention from the real life reports we are getting?
Well, for this election, the honest truth is, I haven't had any issues when it comes to uploading of results, though I understand that the commission says that this election is going to be manually collated and all of that. You see, I was against it when this information came in, and I sent a message to one of the directors in the commission. I said, we spent so much money in doing this. A lot of money was put into this. And now we all agreed that this is the best way for our democratic process. Why will you not cut short after all the monies I've been put into this? And you see, like I said, because politicians are pressing so hard to ensure that they get away with what they want. Look, I tell you, those who win election free, fair, with great merit, will not be given the opportunity, because if elections are collated manually, then of course this is just the beginning of the corruption that we're talking in the electoral process. And that is why we are so much against it. In this election, of course, things are going on, but I tell you, with what we are seeing, with all the feelers we are getting from Kogi and from Imo, in my platform right now, I'm sure somebody is calling me from Imo State, not from my platform. The feelers we are getting, if things are done right, if there is no issue at the coalition center, you'll be surprised who is going to win this election. They will be surprised the election is going the other way.
Why exactly should we be surprised?
Which states?
Well, because right now, everybody thinks that
it's the incumbent.
The incumbent will win the election.
Are you referring to Kogi specifically? Or
Imo and Kogi State, two states.
Okay.
Right now, the feelers I'm getting from this state, even before I got here, I've been receiving very positive information regarding these two states. And what we're seeing, honestly, because the problem is the coalition center, and that's where the fear of everyone is. The coalition center, allow them to do whatever they are doing at the polling unit. We'll take care of it when it gets to the polling. That's what they tell them.
Okay, so but let's go back to Imo State, like you mentioned. And a lot of people have actually said that that attack on the NLC president has a lot to do with this election, and then it's going to dent the image of the incumbent. So, do you agree that that would in any way impact or affect the results coming through?
Well, you know, the Imo State governor was not elected by the people. It was a Supreme Court judgment that brought him in the first place. According to the feelers we received him, he has not done anything outside what he did to what his men did to the NLC president. He hasn't done well in Kogi State, in Imo State.
Are you saying that it was his men that malhandled the
Well, according to what we heard, that the agent of state government were the one that handled the president, NLC president. But let's leave that aside. We are more concerned about what you've done for the people. What are the benefits or the dividends of democracy the people are enjoying? These two states, you can see clearly that people are suffering. Insecurity in the other side of the Imo side. Then, of course, here, the salaries have not been paid for too long. So what we are looking at here is, what have you done for the people? The people will decide based on your achievement. And that is what is happening right now. So, like I said, people from Imo State have been calling us to tell us that, yes, the people have made up their mind and they are ready to go out there, despite all the intimidations and all of that, to cast their ballot for the right person. And likewise in Kogi State, and that is what is happening. And that's why we want the people to be the ultimate decider of this election. And that's just what we stand for. We don't want a situation where they are being intimidated to vote for a particular candidate. And that is what we are against. And I tell you, if things are done properly, just like the president has assured us that this is his first election assignment, and that he wants to ensure that the people becomes the ultimate deciders of this election. Fine, we want to wait to see this happen. And then, of course, the INEC chairman has told us that our experience in the past election has not been too good. The Nigerian people are not too happy about it. We want to ensure that things are done proper. And I think we want to give them the opportunity to see that things are done proper in this election.
Yeah. Well, INEC, particularly the INEC chairman, released a statement or a message on the eve of the election where he said that INEC has no candidate in this election. I have said before that you might wonder why INEC needs to say that.
Yeah.
But then, I guess it's the way things are. But what we're hearing now, I think maybe we'll take a look at it shortly. The PDP candidate is still making allegations. He's alleging that there are instances of vote buying and that funds were being used to sway voters' opinions. He appealed to the moral aspect of the citizens to reject these monies. I'd like to get your thoughts on, you know, the allegations he's making. If I can also add, he also accused INEC over already filled result sheets in possession of some staff in some local government areas. Do you think this is just a case of him trying to get the right thing done, or is it what some people are ascribing as a sign of loss, that he's just trying to get excuses?
Let me start with your second option, the results. Like I told you before I got here, 9:30 this morning, somebody sent me a result sheet already prepared, and the INEC officials have not even got to the polling unit yet. So I think that is going on right now. The INEC chairman, it was brought to the attention of the INEC chairman and the commission itself, and they are on top of it, just like I said.
Okay.
We know that this is going to be a problem if results come even before the elections. and that would be a serious problem. With regard to vote trading, Poly Unit Ambassador of Nigeria, we really stand against this vote trading thing. We know that in 2023 general election, because of our continual fight on this vote trading thing, that's when this idea of a cash crunch came in and all of that. And I think at a point it went a long way. But you know, politicians are always trickish. You know, when you block this way, they look the other way. So what happened was that they took the other way, and they took us unaware too, you know. And that's why they were able to succeed in the general election. But like what Dino is saying, I see in the case of Dino, I'm sure he's also buying votes. The truth about it is the politicians, they all buy votes. That's what they do. So that when you now find out that the other person is doing better than you, then you start making noise.
So it's still an allegation.
Well, I know that politicians, they all buy votes. That's what they do. That's just their way, their way of winning election. There's no way or the other way. That's the way of winning the election. So, but you see, maybe probably because the pressure is, he doesn't have that much money to do what the others are doing, because we know that.
Are you talking of Senator Dino Melahi?
Yeah, because probably the other man is giving 5,000 and you are giving 2,000. And then you see that, and you know, the electorate, one of the problems we have with the electorate is that the highest bidder.
Okay.
I will tell you, let me also tell you, Annabelle, what happened in Oshun, when we went to Oshun, where the vote buying thing was just the last election in Oshun, where at the palace, the King Palace, there's a queue for you collecting money. There's another queue for you to vote. And
at this was happening live
at the King's Palace, at the front gate of the King's Palace in Oshun State. There's a queue, and when we got there, we saw the queue, and we saw five, because they're giving it 10,000. And then of course, there's a lady who came to us and said, "Sir, these people are giving 10,000. I don't want to vote for them. Can you protect my vote?" The reason is that she wants to take the money, but not vote for them, because she knows that voting for them is a lost vote.
But isn't that also a crime?
It's a crime. So we told her it's a crime to collect. But she said, you know what she said? She said, "We do not have money at home. We want to prepare meal. And I think this is an opportunity." That she didn't even come. She has her card, but she refused to come. But somebody called her and said, "Come, they'll give you money." And she came, and she saw that it's real. But now, she's thinking, if she takes this money, she wants her vote protected. And we told her it's a crime, and she explained this to us. That's to tell you how bad the situation is. There are people who don't want to take this money because they want to vote their conscience. But the economic situation is pushing them to the wall.
Okay, just because you said that, we have to just, let's bring that video where you have Senator Dino Melaye saying that, or making some allegations, though, and they will come back to continue on this.
Went around today, and you see they were sharing wrappers. They were sharing wrappers and giving huge sum of money to monetize the consciences of the electorate and the voters. The way to do it is for Nigerians to become born again, is for us to have an attitudinal change. If we want to change this country, it starts from individuals. So every one of us must either walk in the light of creative altruism, or we perish in the darkness of destructive selfishness.
All right, so we've actually seen that video where he made some allegations of what they were sharing, and I hear you say that some people are sharing better than the others, and for the voters it is the highest bidder. But then for someone like Senator Dino Melaye, he has been in this race not yesterday, not today. So you would have thought that probably he might even be one of the highest bidder that you're referring to. So what exactly do you think is playing out here? I hear someone come out. Okay, I hear you say that the ones who complain is the one who is looks like he's losing the election. Mm-hmm. Is that what you see here?
Yeah, well, that's the trend of politicians. Once they beginning to lose election, they beginning to make all sort of noise, and then even indict the commission itself and say the commission has done this and done that because they are losing the election. But look at what is happening in Kogi. The people in Kogi state are going to vote for the leaders of their choice. That's what I'm saying in Kogi. And what I'm seeing also in Imo, the people are going to vote for the leaders of their choice. These politicians will not have that opportunity to rule this election because it's going to be overwhelming.
You believe so?
Yes. And this assertion of mine is based on the performance of these two governors. Imo State has not performed. The outgoing governor of Kogi State has not performed. People are not fools. You have not paid them salary for years. In some cases, you give them 25%. Where is the remaining 75%? And the people are suffering. You just lied to them. The same thing is happening in Imo. There is insecurity. I tell you, people go to Imo. You can't go to Imo State at night. You have to arrive early in the morning. One of my friends who is going to contest, one of our ambassadors who is going to observe the election, have to leave Abuja by road at night to arrive Anambra early morning and then find his way to get into Imo State.
Oh, wow.
That is how bad it is. The people are tired. If I tell you the feelers I'm receiving right here from these two states, including Bayelsa, is that the people will make their choice and their choice cannot be cut short.
All right. Well, we have visuals there of ongoing counting at the, pardon me, open space Ilafun Quarters, Ayetoro. That is for the PDP presidential candidate. We can confirm that he has won it with 210 votes, and others are there. Well, that's what we're saying. But let's move over. We were talking about IRF before and the data on ground. So let's reel out. As at 2:58 p.m., results from 104 out of 2,242 polling units have been submitted on IRF.
Okay.
This is according to, from Imo State, pardon me.
Imo State.
Imo State. That is 104 out of 2,242. Mm. Well, we stay and continue to watch and see how that progresses moving forward. But that aside, let's go back to the issue of vote buying.
Vote buying.
You've talked about, we've talked about the problem. Can we talk about, you know, what could be solutions? If it isn't possible, I don't believe anyone would do it. So what are the measures you think could be put in
place
that could
curtail this vote buying thing?
Yes, in a way that it's not even up to anybody's morality or anybody's level of poverty or wealth. Mm. It is just that they can't do it, you know. So what do you think could be the things put in place?
See, this question they ask, we have submitted our proposal to the former Senate President, Senator Ahmed Lawa. What should be done to ensure that this vote buying thing is a forgotten issue? We have submitted this same proposal to the INEC chairman, Professor Mahmood. We told him, and this proposal, I said, if we do this properly, I tell you, we will stop the vote buying thing 100%.
And so what kind of response did you get?
Now, look at the response. He told us that, the INEC chairman told us that, we do not have the financial backing.
The INEC chairman?
The INEC chairman. We do not have financial backing. It's a good idea. When we had a stakeholder meeting, Polling Unit Ambassador of Nigeria presented it to him, among other CSOs. And he says, we do not have the financial capacity to do this. But let me tell you what it is, what proposal they will give. We found out that politicians will not invest their money where their eyes is not there. No politician will put one naira if he's not sure that that project you are bringing will get him what he wants. He will not put his money there. And how would you handle that? With our experience and our observations, we find out that the KBQ is a problem. The KBQ, when we go in there to thumbprint on the ballot paper, is a problem.
Mm.
Now, because you thumbprint in the KBQ, you need to bring that thumbprinted ballot paper to put in the ballot box outside the KBQ.
Mm.
We have seen several times that even the president and now the governors are exposing it to the world, which is not allowed, which is an electoral fraud. We told the INEC chairman, provide an envelope inside a KBQ for every electorate. When I go and thumbprint on my ballot paper, I will fold that ballot paper and put it inside that envelope. And I will come out of the KBQ and take it down inside the ballot box. Nobody sees it. It's a crime. If you do not put your ballot paper inside the envelope and you bring it out, it's a crime. You can be arrested.
Mm.
Now,
just a moment. Is this
a amendment? No, it's a proposal.
Yes. Is it assuming the cubicle has not changed, or are you also proposing changes to the cubicle.
No, what we
because I mean, from what I've seen, you have someone standing behind you can still see what you are doing.
Now, our second option, after the ballot paper is put into the envelope, put in the ballot box, that has handled exposing the ballot paper.
Mm.
Now the cubicle, because as you are there, they know that you are tomprit. If you tomprit at the top, they know which part you tomprited because they are looking at you at the back.
Mm.
So we say provide a blind, a window blind.
Mm.
Provide a window blind. We know, like in the medical stuff, you enter, there's a window blind that will not allow someone outside to see. So provide a window blind, somebody will go in there and tomprit without nobody seeing it. Without is a open secret ballot system. So provide a window blind. And look, when we made that presentation, the NH chairman and even the Senate president welcomed this idea. The Senate president told us that they will make an amendment to this, to the Electoral Act, to capture this. But as of the 2020 general elections, when we presented to the NH chairman, he said, we are trying to cut costs. We can be asking for more money. Do you know what it costs to get envelope for every electorate? How much does it cost for? No, the ones we spent so much money on, we did not use them.
Mm.
After spending so much, hundreds of millions on Naira, we've not used them. So what is it to get an envelope to get things right? If we have to get things right, why don't you do the right thing to get it right? So that's why I said that there's a lot of complicity in this whole system.
Well, what about the security forces? Don't you think, or do you think perhaps they are letting a lot of these things happen? Because I believe with the way the elections are being held, it should be easy to sort of create this,
control crowd.
The point is, if someone is buying votes,
yes,
they have to be positioned in such a way as to see what they are buying. And I believe such person should be easily spotted by any security operative.
Politicians are very clever. They are very smart in this. They don't, the vote buying thing, the person who is buying the votes, is not at that polling unit environment. It's at the polling unit community, far from the polling unit itself. I said this is already an organized crime. The agents are there seeing what is happening, and they will just call this person, whoever he is, because this person knows that he has to collect his balance. So what they do is that they say, okay, the lady with the red shirt voted for us, you can balance her money. The person is not there. The person is hidden somewhere. But the electorate know where the person is. In Ekiti, I think our last election in Ekiti, we caught some few persons.
All right, let's quickly go straight to Bayelsa, where our correspondent is standing by to give us exactly what is happening in his area. Hello, Khalid. Are you there, Khalid? Khalid, are you there? Good afternoon. All right, so please go ahead.
Mm-hmm. So, like I said, the electorate already know where these vote buyers, they already know. Because, you know, like I said, the economic situation is the one pushing some of these persons. But I'm really liking what is happening in Kogi now, where we even had those who came to buy their vote are chased away from the polling unit. Nigerians must learn that if you sell your vote, you sell your future. Because those people who are buying your vote, they are business people. It's like going to the market to buy a product. You want to sell to make profit.
But do you think integrity can stand in place of hunger, so to speak? When someone is hungry and they're just trying to survive, like the example you pointed out, that they just want to go and cook.
Mm.
You know, taking it to another angle, another issue now that is gaining some level of attention that people are trying to solve. The issue of awaiting trial in our prison systems, pardon me, our correctional system, where you see about 70% of people are awaiting trial. And it has been discovered that a vast majority of people simply can't pay fines. Say 5,000 naira fine, they can't pay. And they just spend years, decades in jail because they can't pay 5,000 naira. Taking that here, when someone is poor, impoverished, hungry, you know, can they really have morals?
But let me tell you that poverty does not give us excuse to do what we're doing. We have to be disciplined. Mm. And I always tell people that you have to be disciplined.
Okay.
There are things that I want, that I think I should have, but I don't have them. And discipline has get me this far to say, okay, if I don't have them, there's no reason for me to do the other way around. So those who are selling their votes, you don't give me the excuse because you want to eat, you are hungry, and that you sell your votes. Because that food is going to be a day or 2 days' food that you are talking about here. So what happened after these days? What will happen? So you must be disciplined. You must tell yourself that I will not sell my vote. And I believe that the man that I'm going to cast my vote for, even if he doesn't win, maybe because of electoral malpractice, I have done the right thing. We must begin to discipline ourselves to that position. Somebody was telling me recently that they are trying to offer you money to do something and then you're not doing it. I said, look, the fact is that because we need the money does not mean that we must do that which is wrong. And let me also use the opportunity to talk to politicians. Let me use this medium to talk to politicians. You know, most of our politicians are not in the field. They don't know what's happening. Some of them don't even go to cast their vote on the day of elections. So they just do that and then go back to their houses and watch the television, what is happening. But those who are in the field are telling you that this is what you need to do. I keep telling politicians to invest at the polling unit community. Invest at the polling unit community. Because at the polling unit community, nobody is going to rig that election. Nobody is going to rig the election, especially if the commission decides to do the right thing.
All right. Let's see if our correspondent in Bayelsa is ready. Khalid. Hello, Khalid. Are you ready to talk to us? Good afternoon. I can see all smiles on your face this afternoon. What is happening in Bayelsa this afternoon?
Putting materials going to Southern Ijaw local government of the state, and as you know, the state has 8 local governments with 5 only accessible by rail, by boat. Now, our election materials going to Southern Ijaw local government capsized, and you know, he promised that they are making efforts to, you know, replace the materials there. And he also mentioned that the supervising presiding officer at Sagbama local government was abducted. However, he promised also that voting would also happen there. Now I'm live at Yenagoa Unit 4, Ward 4, Unit 6, where
all right, so where you are is quite noisy. We are battling with hearing what you're saying, but if you can hear me, what exactly is happening with regards to security? Because I can see that the crowd is really crowded. Let me use Nigerian language. All right, Khalid, just hold on right there. Let's go on a quick break so that we can be able to work on these technical issues, because we're finding it difficult getting straight to hear you very well. Let's go on a quick break, and when we return, we'll continue on the live broadcast with regards to the off-season election. See you. We'll be right back. All right, welcome back. So, Khalid, go ahead. Tell us what is happening. We still hear that noise happening there. Is there? Do you have any infractions there?
INEC officials already mentioned that they would end voting by 3:30. Meanwhile, there are still people yet to be accredited and to also cast their vote. So party agents are trying to, you know, convince them to extend the voting time to 4 p.m. That is what is happening right now.
Okay, that's good to know. So all through when you've been there since yesterday, because I know you went to Bayelsa since Thursday and you've been on standby. what will you tell us with regards to security? Does that, do you have any reason to fear? Because I know at some point you need to cross water and at some point you need to stand on land. What is happening in that regard?
You know, regards security agencies, you know, earlier we visited the INEC staff complex here in Bayelsa, you know, the capital, and we obviously saw, you know, agents of security agents, particularly the police and the Nigerian Army. And, you know, going through the streets of Bayelsa, you can also, you know, witness the heavy presence at almost 500 meters. You'd see either a checkpoint of the police or the army. But then the only comma we seem to have, or, you know, the only misconception is regarding the boat that capsized at Southern Ijo. You know, speaking with some of the residents, they mentioned the fact that it could have been something that was instigated and not just a natural phenomenon, because they mentioned that it is not common for boats to capsize, you know, around that area. But, you know, that is not unconfirmed at the moment. However, if we hear more about that, we would definitely report back to the station.
All right. Okay.
Go ahead.
Khalid, can you hear me? Okay. My question is as regards, I believe one of your updates, you spoke about vote buying. Did you observe that yourself?
Yes, you know, that was around Yenagoa. I can't really remember the ward and the unit now. But, you know, in one of my updates, I was there. And just while I was trying to capture images of people voting, I noticed that there was an argument by the left side of the clip. And, you know, turning there, I saw that, okay, they were arguing over money. It was actually an argument of money, and, you know, that was why I was able to deduce that, okay, it was probably a case of vote buying that was happening. But in every other polling units I've been to, it has generally been free, fair, and, you know, transparent.
All right, so what can you tell us with regards to the electorate themselves? Do they look happy? Is it what happened during the 2023 general elections? Is it happening again in terms of fear and trepidation? But are you having voter apathy for all the polling units that you checked since this morning till this minute?
You know, generally looking at the election, and, you know, in my conversation with residents, it was confirmed that these elections seem to be a new turn of events, particularly, you know, ranging, looking at it from the perspective of the last general elections. It was affirmed that this election seems to be one that is fairer, and for the fact that we have more residents, particularly the youth. Now, if you look at the number of registered voters, it is affirmed that 42% of the registered voters are youths. And, you know, we understand the fact that the youths are the movers and shakers of the country. Therefore, you know, I would say that there is no form of apathy, because from every local government, we found that, okay, people were out to vote, and, you know, generally the voting process has been smooth. You know, different from what we're having here right now, the process has been quite seamless.
Okay, so I hear you say the youth are more interested in voting this time. Now, you have people crowded around you, right behind you. What exactly are they waiting to do? Are they waiting to ensure that I cast my vote and I see to it that at the end my vote counts? Or what exactly are they doing there?
Yeah, behind me are, you know, party agents as well as voters that are still waiting to be accredited. As I mentioned earlier, the INEC officials want to end voting process by 3:30, while the residents are trying to extend that to 4 o'clock. So they are trying to convince them now. I don't know if they've been able to convince them for the voting process to continue. However, if they are not able to convince them, I guess counting will commence.
Do you think you can actually talk to one person, if you can talk to someone and then find out their own personal thoughts with regard to how the election process is going?
Then, you know, we'll hear the side of the story. Excuse me, sir.
I'm coming.
Hello. Would you be willing to speak to us, you know, just to give us your opinion of how the election has run since the beginning and up to this moment? All right. There's someone here. Good afternoon.
Yes.
Good afternoon, sir.
Sorry, just one person. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon. Thank you. Good afternoon. Okay, Swahili Sobadaya John Osumu.
Are you a party agent here, or you know, just an observer?
Yes, I'm a party agent. You can see my tag.
All right. So, what is your general opinion of the election? You know, how has the election been so far since the commencement?
Okay. I believe that we, the Akenfa people, indigenous and non-indigenous, we came in mass, vote massively. We are fully satisfied with the process. You can see the arena very peaceful, both parties exercising their franchise. So at this juncture, we are the concluding part. So we did well. The masses did well here.
Would you just say only the masses that contributed to the seamless process, or the efforts of the security officers, particularly the police?
Okay, on that part, I'm really obliged that the security men, they did well. All did well.
How about the NEC officials? Were they here on time? And you know, has the beavers been working well?
The NEC official came on time. Till now, there has been no rancor. We have been open. So,
thank you very much.
All right.
All right, let's find one more person to speak with. We have one more person, stand by.
Okay.
Yes, we have one more person.
Go ahead, please.
Hello, good afternoon. Hello.
Yeah, good afternoon. Thank you.
Your name, please.
I'm Robinson Gift.
Are you an agent? Just a
I am the youth president of Akenfa APA communities currently. So I came to observe the process to maintain, to ensure that there is peace in the arena. I think that's my responsibility as a youth leader here.
What has been your observation of the election so far?
Well, my observation so far is that the election processes went on free and fair. It was smooth. There was no issue of harassment of any kind. There was no any kind of assault or attacking of opposition parties. The whole area was calm. The election was free and fair. I think if you can see, the process is still ongoing. Smoothly.
Now, what is happening over here? Is it that they want to conclude the election now and people are asking to continue, or what?
Yes, I think the election, according to them, that their timing was supposed to be 2:30 p.m. and some persons came late. So I think what is happening there now, there is a plea that those people that came late should also be allowed to exercise their franchise.
Don't you think people should have just come at the, you know, at the allotted time?
Normally, you know, in Africa, there is what they call African man time, you know. Everybody has their own business, not until maybe they later gain consciousness before they put the public activities to consideration. I think that was just what happened.
Now, how would you rate the performance of this election coming from the perspective of security and, you know, the efforts of the Independent National Electoral Commission, comparing it to the general election? How would you, you know, rate this?
I think what has happened here so far, the security that we are on ground, they did very well in trying to ensure that there is calmness and restiveness. I think compared to the general election, I think the ones here, they did very well.
How about, you know, the participation of the residents? Did people actually come out than the presidential election?
Yes, to an extent, you know, governorship election is usually very paramount compared to that of the presidential election. You know, the people are so concerned in making their personal choices on who to govern them directly. You know, the governorship election is something that happens to do like a kind of direct leadership. So I think the turn up compared to that of the presidential is a kind of compared to the presidential. The presidential was more due to the general involvement of the people. You know, as you can see, most persons have traveled back home to vote for their choices. That is why I think the numbers of voters on this one is kind of reduced. But the participation is more serious than that of the presidential.
Thank you very much for your time. I really appreciate it. Yes, there you have it. You mentioned the fact that perhaps due to, you know, people has traveled back to their hometown to vote, and that is why they're having a lower turnout here at this unit than they had during the presidential elections.
All right. Very well said. Thank you so much, Khalid Baba. We'll call you later again to find out what's happening regards to vote counting and collation. Thank you so much. Stay safe right there.
Thank you, Khalid.
All right. I'll be on standby. Thank you very much.
Most definitely. Right. Okay. So that was Khalid. Let's come back here again and then talk about the Bayelsa elections, because now he talked about the boat capsizing, and then he talked about some persons who were abducted, and then he talked about elections both on land and then in water. And then some people will tell you that the fact that I have to go through water safe is even enough reason for me not to even go to that election, not to talk of even going anywhere close. But then with all that he has said with regards to security, and then you had some of the respondents, you had some of the respondents say that it's far better than what they've been having all along. So does this make Puan optimistic that it is a good outing for INEC?
Good. Well, before I get to that, I would like to, as an observation I have there, you see, each time you send your reporters out, it's better to get a true picture of the fillers of what's happening on election day. If he has to interview one person, he has to be an electorate, somebody who is casting his vote. If he has to do for two persons, he has to be an observer and electorate. He has to do for three, he has to do with the security. In short, party agent should be the last person that you should interview.
But most times, you have security agents who will not even want to.
Well, okay, but these first two, electorate and observers, to give you the better picture of what you're expecting.
Yeah, we've actually called him before, and we've had others.
Okay, because, you know, because the party agent will always want to play the game to suit whatever, and because they are taking that opportunity to speak to always before even the election is concluded in that polling unit. You can imagine how a party agent will play it to his own advantage and all of that. So we are very careful with that. But with what we had, I think I'm very happy, very optimistic that the elections, both in Kogi, Bayelsa, and Imo, are going on well. There's no rancor, there's no trouble like we expected before the election. We know it's like a war zone and all of that, and that's what we're expecting. But we thank God, God has taken care of this, and things are going well. I believe that at the end of the day, the result, which is the most important part of this election, is what we're waiting for. And I'm sure the result is going to be fine. We are going to be happy, yes.
All right. But did you expect what we're seeing in Bayelsa now? Some might say it's the tamest of the three so far. But away from that, our own correspondent speaking there now, it's not a third-party account, said he also witnessed scuffles regarding, you know, vote buying and all of that. You know, what do you think should be, or do you think we should see more of the resultant punishments? Because when we hear and say a lot of these things, we never see the end of the story. There's even videos trending, I believe, during the Ekiti election, off-season election, back in last year, where some young persons took to social media and they were waving around the money they collected to sell their votes, you know, in blatant view of the public. So how do you think these situations can end in a way that sets a deterrent for others?
First, like you said, the legal aspect. But let's start with this option that we gave to the commission. Like I said earlier, nobody's going to put his money where he won't be in control. If a politician knows that if I give my money out and the place where this money will be used has been blocked, he won't give that money. That's the first point to discourage vote buying. If that is done, our option, our proposal to INEC, if that is done, you would have discouraged vote buying. Now, let's go further. A lot of those vote buying issues that we had. People who buy these votes, we are caught on camera live buying these votes. And those even selling the votes. At the end of the day, nothing is done. We understand in Ekiti, some persons were arrested. Today, where are they? There's no courts, there's no punishment. And that's where the problem is. And for us, we gave an option. If you are found to have committed a crime against our electoral law, if, and I said, if you are a contender for that election and you are caught, and it has been proven by the court that yes, you are found guilty of this act, you should be banned from election process for the next 10 years. I told someone, I said, if anybody can buy your vote, that person can buy virtually anything. So we must disallow this. If it is proven by the court of law that yes, this person is guilty of this charge, then that person should be banned for participating in active politics for the next 10 years. I tell you,
as a voter or as a candidate?
As a candidate. Well, I'm saying as a candidate now. Okay. Because this money is a candidate that deal dollar this money for people to go and sell. Yeah. So if at the end of the day, you the court of law confirmed that yes, you are guilty of this, you shouldn't participate in any active. Like what we did, we said, if you, the man in Taraba State where he was found that he forged, he was banned for 5 years, right? And of course, it's standing because that was the reason why he was out for the next, for these elections that they, with the ministerial, whatever, and all of that. So for me, those very strangers conditions must be put in place.
Okay, so if you're putting these conditions to the candidates themselves, what will you talk about the electorate or the security officials who are complicit in this?
Who aid them, yes.
Because like I said, when we started using the Nigerian language, suffer no, they tire you. Mm. The same suffer that happens in one person's house happens also in your own house because you cannot be a one-eyed man in the land of the blind. If you're too rich and too comfortable, people around you definitely will throw stones at you and they will definitely come back to eat from you. So does it actually mean that the electorates who indulge in this or allow themselves to be indulged in this or who allow themselves to be used by this candidate to become thugs, to dole out money and then kill people and kidnap people and so on and so forth, suffer not their own side too?
So I think to answer that question, I say if we give a 10 years for the contender, we should also say a 3 or 5 years for the one who sells his vote. And I think that will go a long way to disallow this idea of buying, selling votes. Because, people will say, give excuse because of the economic situation. But we have to tell them that if you are caught, if you look at one of our various videos that we did, if you sell votes or you buy votes, you'll go to jail. So if we say you're going to jail, let the contender go for 10 years and let the one who sell go for 5 years.
So at what point does this start? Because now you bring the security officials, now pick this person and then send this person to police custody or the EFCC. But then you remember that the person who sent the that person to go share the money or pick the money, then it's a long chain.
Of course,
it's a long network. Mm-hmm. So it means that the person who started it might be somewhere locking around to go bring out that person from the same prison. So at what point do you start this then?
But let me tell you that even when there are boys that are sent to go and do this, that's why sometimes this thing fails. Because once they are caught and they know that they're going to go to jail, there's this a plea bargain, you know, the court of law always come up with a plea, give us your, we are not after you, we are after your master. Give us your master, and that's the end of it. And I tell you, sometimes they play around these laws and you see, you get the, because the laws are there, but they are not being affected. That's where the problem is. And if
so it's not like there's a drought.
When it comes to the laws are there, but it's just that, and the people who are supposed to affect the law, make the law work, are those who we are talking about. Those are the senators, the members of House of Rep, the governors, the president. They are the one even frustrating the whole system. So that's why things are not really working.
Then what will you talk about the judiciary then?
Well, the judiciary, honestly, before now, the judiciary has been one hope of the common man, but I tell you, as of today, they've also lost integrity. They lost trust. We don't even trust them anymore. Because the truth about it, there are a lot of things going on. And I told them, I said, any election that is not won at the polling unit is already a fraud. The court does not have power to give you a winning post for the election. The court does not have that right.
I mean, but there are cases where, I mean, the judgment does...
Because well. We didn't do the right thing.
Who didn't do the right thing?
The commission, like we say, the proposer. If we do the right thing at the polling unit, I tell you, we will not have... Most of our election cases now are in court. They're in court. And why should they be in court in the first place? So because the things are not done right. If things are done right at the polling unit level, this is the smallest unit, but the most powerful unit. If you do the right thing at the polling unit, there is no way people will go into court. Because election will be won fair and square at the polling unit. If he loses, he loses at the polling unit. If he wins, he wins at the polling unit. But because things are not done at the polling unit properly, or the things are done at the polling unit and at the collection center, you have issues. These are the problems. But I tell you, if we implement the report of the polling unit ambassadors of Nigeria in this country, as I tell you, Abeta Madi, in the next election, if we implement it properly, you will find out that we will have no issue with electoral fraud. Because people of integrity will be the one coming to contest for election. Because you know, at the end of the day, it is not the usual game. You know that if you don't have the people by your side, you will not come to contest election, because you will surely lose the election.
All right then, now let's go straight to take some more feeds, live feeds from our correspondent in Kogi, Bayelsa and Imo that will come to conclude this segment before we take our next call from Kogi State. We'll see you after this time out. Join us again.